This is the 2020 Toyota Supra, and it's one of the most controversial new cars on the market. The last Supra offered in North America went out of production after the 1998 model year, and since then, its legend has grown, and so has the desire for a new one. Well, the new one is finally here, and today, I'm going to review it. First, a little overview. Now, the Supra first came out in the 1970s, and the early models were based on the Toyota Celica. In the 1980s, the Supra became its own model, and then in 1993, Toyota rolled out the Mark IV Supra, which would later go on to become famous for its role in the Fast and the Furious, and is now generally recognized as one of the most desirable sports cars from the 1990s. But after 1998, the Supra went out of production, and in the years since, its legend has only grown. Enthusiasts have become obsessed with the Supra's robust 2JZ engine and its immense tuning potential. And as the Supra's legend has grown, so has the pressure on Toyota to bring it back, to revive the Supra, to bring back the sports car icon. And as the pressure grew, so did the hype. Everyone was excited for the new Supra. And this is it. This is the new Supra. Although, there are a few major points of controversy. For one, the Supra is one of the most famous Japanese sports cars ever, but the new one isn't built in Japan. They build it in Austria, and that's because it's based on the BMW Z4, which is another point of controversy. You see, the outgoing Supra used Toyota's most famous engine ever, the 2JZ six-cylinder, but this one uses a BMW engine and a lot of other BMW bits, which I'll show you in a minute. And there's other stuff too. The Supra is only offered with an automatic transmission. And while the BMW Z4 offers up to 380 horsepower, the Supra only has 335 horsepower from the same engine. The Supra is less powerful than the car it's based on. This hardly seems like the legendary status of the Supra that we're all accustomed to, but is it any good? Well, today we're gonna find out. First, I'm going to take you on a tour of the new Supra, and I'm going to show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then I'm gonna get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the new Supra, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also rounded up a list of the highest mileage used Toyota models currently listed for sale on Autotrader. All right, I'm going to start the quirks and features of the Toyota Supra by discussing its deficiencies, all of which were told to me by Toyota in the single most bizarre press briefing I have ever been a part of. I go to a lot of these automaker press launches where they fly journalists in. I pay for my own flights to keep my objectivity, but they fly journalists in and they show them a new car, but I've never had one where they went around showing the deficiencies like they did in this car. Basically, they showed us all the areas where they could have improved it, but instead they held back so that tuning companies could later improve it if they wanted to, because they know there's a big tuner market for this car. So I'm gonna start up front. This front air dam here provides cooling to the engine, obviously, and apparently when Toyota first started testing this car, they realized it provided too much cooling. And so they blocked off the bottom part so it didn't cool the engine too much. And their thinking is that tuning companies can go in and open it up more for better cooling if they get more power out of it. And it's the same story right here. A lot has been made about the fact that the new Supra has a lot of fake vents on the outside. Well, Toyota told me these aren't fake, but they're dummy vents for tuning companies. When they start to get more power, they can pull the vent out of here and use this for better downforce or for brake cooling. And it's the same story with the vent on the hood. Right now, it's a dummy vent, fake, but tuning companies can pull it out and use this to create a channel from the front vent to the hood vent for better downforce. And this continues under the hood. You open up the hood, and once again, Toyota showed us an area where they intentionally dumbed down the Supra so that tuning companies have an opportunity in the aftermarket. You can see there's a space here where you could mount an extra brace for better chassis stiffness, but Toyota didn't do it. There's even holes where you could screw one in, but Toyota decided to skip it and not add that chassis stiffness and leave that for the aftermarket. And it gets even more unusual than that. In this presentation, Toyota also told the journalists that the material the rear hatch is made out of wasn't strong enough to support a rear wing. But they know that the tuning companies will be adding a rear wing, so Toyota added stronger material to this section of the rear hatch so that a wing could be added and it wouldn't just fly off. In other words, Toyota added more complexity, more weight, and probably more expense so that tuning companies could mount a wing? Same deal with the differential. There's no factory differential cooler in this car, but Toyota says they left a space for one so that tuning companies can go in and put a differential cooler on when they get more power and people start to use it on the racetrack. Now, the reason I find this to be so unusual is I have heard explanations of automakers leaving holes for tuning companies to be able to do things. Jeeps do this frequently, for example, but there are so many obvious places where Toyota could have improved this car, why didn't they just do it themselves? Could it be that maybe Toyota left all of these holes, all of these fake vents that could become real vents, this ability to mount a spoiler to the back? Could it be that Toyota left this stuff so that Toyota, not the tuning companies, can make a better version of the Supra in the future? I actually asked this question to the Japanese project manager responsible for the entire Supra. I said, could Toyota just fill this stuff and make a faster Supra? I asked it to his translator translated, he got the response translated back to me, and simply it was, yes, we can. Not we will, mind you, but we can. He seemed to be very aware of the implications of what I was asking. So maybe this is just the beginning of the Supra, and maybe there's even more to come. But anyway, on to more quirks and features, and I want to get back under the hood. Now, Toyota seemed to be very proud of the fact that they have two hood latches on this car. They said the project manager, his mentor, told him that sports cars should have two hood latches for high-speed stability. But of course, I think the real reason is because BMW has two hood latches on the Z4, and so this car does too. I'm not sure there's really much more to it than that. Now, under here you can see the engine, and it is pretty healthy. 335 horsepower, 365 pound-feet of torque, both very good numbers. Now, I was curious how much I would have to poke around in the engine bay to find BMW, and the truth is, it's the first thing you see. Mounted the very furthest forward next to the latch, it says BMW, and it also says BMW on this wire, and it also says BMW right here, and so there are quite a few different spots under the hood where it says BMW. But I want to get one thing out of the way real quick. I'm not entirely sure why that's a bad thing. There's been a lot of negativity about the fact that Toyota would seek out BMW to build a sports car. I can't believe the new Supra is just a BMW underneath. But since when is that a problem? This is the company that gave us the M1, the E30 M3, the 1 Series M, the M2 Competition, the M3, the M4, the M5. BMW has a great history of building some great sports cars. And frankly, I don't see it as a huge issue that the Supra has a BMW power plant. I just wish it had more power to match the BMW, and obviously you worry a little bit about reliability. One of the reasons people buy Toyotas is reliability and dependability. You stick a German engine in one, and it starts to get a little nerve-wracking. But in today's world, you basically need a partner to build a sports car. The BRZ and the FRS, the Miata and the Fiat 124, and now this. So I guess it was BMW or no Supra at all. By the way, it's also worth noting that the new Supra does 0 to 60 in 4.1 seconds. Toyota told me that is the quickest Toyota ever made. So that's a pretty good thing. And next up, I want to talk about a few style details of the Supra. I want to start with the front turn signals, which look very interesting. Instead of a little small piece, it takes up basically the entire side and bottom of this whole front headlight assembly. It looks really, really cool, very distinctive, and I think that is a good little turn signal look. And in back, it's the same story. I really love the look of the brake lights in this car. They are tremendously distinctive, and the turn signals are just part of the brake lights. One of the brake lights turns off and becomes the turn signal when you put it on. And I think that looks really, really cool. I can't think of any other car in the industry that has a similar looking brake light design, very unique to the Supra. Now, another cool thing I love in the back of the new Supra, the Supra badge. They are still using the same Supra font from the Mark IV Supra, which I just think is a fantastic little touch that ties this car into the old one. I've always loved that very 90s font, and I'm so glad they had enough of a sense of humor and of history to keep the Supra font going in the new one. And next up, since we're back here, I want to talk about a few other important Supra details. One is the fact that integrated into the rear diffuser, you have this little light that looks like the rain light in Formula One cars, which I think is fantastic. Now, some other exotic cars also do this. They do it for the rear fog light, but in this car, it's the reverse light, which just looks so cool. Every time you put it in reverse, this weird little light comes on. Again, a very distinctive design touch in back. Now, one other distinctive thing in back is the sound of this car. I have to say, it sounds pretty good. Take a listen. Now, one other thing I want to discuss before I move on to the Supra's interior quirks and features is the styling. And I want to start with this fender. Now, Toyota was very proud of this fender. They said a special machine had to be created to make it and blah, blah, blah. I don't care about any of that stuff. But I do like how it looks. In fact, it gives this car kind of a Ferrari F12, F12 TDF look from the right angles. And I don't say that negatively. I think this is a really, really nice looking angle. And generally, I think the car looks good. There has been some criticism of the Supra's styling online ever since it came out. But truthfully, most people hate all new cars they see until they get a little familiar with them. And sitting here and looking at a bunch of new Supras, frankly, I think it actually looks pretty good. Any complaints I have about the new Supra are not directed at how it looks. I think it's a nice looking car, and I think they did a good job modernizing a legend. Now, next, moving on to the Supra's interior quirks and features, I want to talk about the cargo area, and I want to start with simply accessing the cargo area, which is a little bit annoying because there's no little button down here to pop it open when the Supra is unlocked. Instead, your only access is through a button on the driver's door panel or a button on the key fob. You push it, it pops open, and then you can open it from here. And when you do open it, you'll discover that the opening is actually surprisingly narrow. This car has a fairly decent amount of cargo space, but the opening is narrower than the actual cargo area, and so there's some stuff you might not even be able to get in, even though it fits, which is maybe a little bit of a disappointment, although I'm not really sure how many people are going to try to use this as a practical car. Now, one very interesting thing in the cargo area is the fact that it has an emergency inside release for the passenger to climb out in case you try to kidnap someone in your Supra. I say this is interesting because the cargo area is open to the passenger area. So if someone kidnaps you in a Supra, you could pull that thing and fly out on the highway, or, you know, you could just crawl into the front compartment and punch them in the face while they're driving or something. And next we move on to the passenger compartment of the new Supra, where there are quite a few interesting quirks and features. The first one, you notice the moment you go to get inside, the door sill is very wide. In fact, Toyota says the door sill is twice as wide as it is in normal Toyota models, and that's for added stiffness. Now, usually there's a lot of manufacturer talk about stiffness, and I don't believe much of it, but in this case I do, because Toyota says this is the stiffest Toyota ever, even stiffer than the LFA, so obviously adding more support there probably helps. And the other interesting, kind of cool thing in that door sill down there is you have the Supra logo. That old school 90s Supra font is repeated down there, and I just love it. It's a wonderful touch, and it is a welcome reminder of what this car is, because after you see that Supra logo, the next thing you see is the rest of this interior, which is all BMW. I knew this car would have a BMW powertrain, but I didn't know just how BMW it would be. The window switches are from BMW. The mirror control is from BMW. The turn signal stock, BMW. The wiper stock, BMW. The headlight control. The steering wheel is straight out of BMW, except it has a Toyota badge on it. The climate controls, directly from BMW. All of the center console controls, right out of BMW. The climate vents are BMW. Even that little thing I like, where you slide your finger over the radio presets and the screen tells you what is involved with each one, that is from BMW, and that's because the entire infotainment system in this car is also from BMW. Basically, everything you see is BMW stuff. Now, I will say, with the infotainment system, I have to give them credit, because on the flight out here, I was thinking, I'm gonna go through every screen on that infotainment system and see if I can find where it says BMW. I did that, and it doesn't. They've changed it all. For example, if you go into the BMW connected drive system in this car, it says Toyota Supra Connect. If you go into the safety systems menu, it doesn't say like BMW active safety, it says Toyota Supra safety. They did a very thorough like control F and replace everything that said BMW or BMW Z4 or whatever, and everything in here says Toyota. Even the pictures, when you're talking about the tailgate, for instance, it shows a picture of a Supra with the tailgate up and not a Z4. They didn't make any of those mistakes, which of course is nice and very welcome. But with that said, this infotainment system really is exactly the same one in an enormous amount of modern BMW models, and I've reviewed this infotainment system in several other new BMWs, the new 3 Series, the new Z4, and so I won't be going through it in detail. We'll link those reviews in the description if you want to check it out. Now, other interesting quirks and features in this interior beyond all of the BMW stuff. One interesting quirk is the giant sport button in the center console. You can see it's mounted above another button that is actually 3 buttons, and in that space you have just one giant sport button above it. I guess they really want you to press that sport button and go into sport mode. And speaking of interesting buttons in this interior, I mentioned that there was a button over on the driver's door panel you could press to release the tailgate. You push it and it kind of pops open. Well, over on the passenger side, where that button would be in a right-hand drive car, there's a plug. They actually just cover it. Instead of creating a new door panel to hide it, you can see that it should have been there, but it isn't. And speaking of the door panels, take a look at the driver's door panel. You see it's a nice red to match the seats. Now, move over to the passenger door panel. You see anything different over there? It's black. Now, I assume this is because this is a pre-production, very early car, and I am at the launch here. This is not a car that will eventually be sold to the public, so you have to give Toyota a pass on that. Magnus Steyr in Austria, who builds this car, will never screw that up. They are too good. But it's kind of funny to see that in a car nonetheless, even though we know that mismatched door panels will not make production. Now, next up, I want to move on to one piece of technology which is very different from the Z4, and that would be the gauge cluster, which actually is completely different, doesn't really share anything. And I really like the gauge cluster in the Supra. I love this giant center tachometer that's fixed in place. It looks really cool. And if you put the car in sport mode, you can see it gets just a little bit more aggressive and red and angry, letting you know things are about to get sportier. I also really like over on the sides, you have the fuel gauge and the temperature gauge, and they have these little white bars across and that tells where you are. I think all that stuff looks really good, and I think this is a fantastic gauge cluster. And finally, one other noteworthy item in this car, one difference from this car to the Z4. In the Z4, you have a center console for storage that also has cup holders in it. You can kind of fold the lid back and use the cup holders or use it for storage. This car, they just ditched the storage aspect of it, so the center console in this car is only for cup holders, although they are nice and large and cup holdery. And so those are the quirks and features of the new Toyota Supra. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the 2020 Toyota Supra, which is obviously a really big deal. It's been 20 years, you know, this car has kind of a lot of hype around it. So what is it like to drive? Now I want to start off by talking about the transmission situation with this car. There is only an automatic available, which sort of seems like sacrilege for a vehicle like the Supra, and a lot of people complained about that. Then there was backlash about the complaints. Well, you're not buying a new one, you only want used cars, so that's what you do now, you make it automatic. I actually deeply disagree. I think this car needs to have a manual transmission. And I don't generally say that about cars. I don't feel that Ferrari should bring back the manual. I get why Porsches don't have them as much as they used to. I get all that. I generally don't complain. But I was told many times at this press launch that the target vehicle for the Supra was the Porsche Boxster and Cayman. If you want to be serious about competing with two of the best smaller sports cars on the market, you need a manual. And if you're going to make a car like the Nissan GTR with 600 horsepower and it's trying to be as fast as possible in a straight line, fine. But that's not what they're doing here, clearly, because they've detuned it compared to the Z4. And this car should have 3 pedals. That is a mistake. And I think that's, in my mind, honestly, the biggest flaw of the entire car. As for the driving experience, I have driven the car pretty extensively today, and I like it. I think this car drives really well. I knew I would because I drove the Z4 about a month ago, and it drove great. And I kind of figured this actually may not be so bad. You know, the prior body Z4 wasn't the world's greatest sports car. It just wasn't. But the new one is better, and I kind of figured, well, then the Supra will be too, and it is. And I only drove the four-cylinder Z4. This is basically a better version of that, and it has more power. It's great. I drove it on the racetrack. Dynamically, it is wonderful. It's a nice car to drive. It's well-balanced. It feels good. It is a little bit let down by this transmission. Toyota, in a presentation this morning, said, well, it's almost as good as a dual clutch. Well, how about just use a dual clutch then? I think this automatic is kind of the weak point of the car in a couple of ways. But truthfully, I'm driving it around, driving it on back roads, kind of having fun. You don't want for power. You really, really do not want for power. It feels fun, it feels exciting, and it's nice. Which leads me to my next point, which is I hope this is the base car. Like I mentioned, I really wonder if Toyota is going to make a more powerful Supra. As I told you, the project manager was kind of coy about it. They could make a better one. Well, I wonder if they will. And if they do, and this is just the base car, the starting point, then it's a great one. Because dynamically, it's good. It drives well. It feels good. I think there's more that can come from this chassis. By the way, one other interesting item worth mentioning with this car, there's an odd wind thing that goes on. If you have the windows down and you're going over about 50 miles an hour, the like buffeting, it messes with your inner ear. You almost can't hear it. I don't know if it's coming through on camera. Driving this car, the acceleration is good. The sound is surprisingly good. I think there's a ton of great stuff about this car. I just think it doesn't quite live up to the legend. And by the way, I like the new Acura NSX. I think that car is great, and I stand by that 4 or 5 years after it has come out. But I think this car falls a little bit short. The NSX at least had big power, and it basically does 0-60 like McLarens and Ferraris. This, in a world where, look, the halo car from back then, the Supra, was the 320 horsepower King of the Road Super Turbo. And the Skyline GTR was about 320 horsepower Skyline GTR. They were neck and neck. Now the GTR has whatever it is, 585, some insane horsepower. Does 0-60 in 2.5 seconds. And this is all the Supra is, really? I almost feel like Toyota didn't quite understand how much the legend of the Supra had grown. And they released this car. They were like, oh, we can make a good sports car and it'll be the Supra. And they couldn't. Maybe 20 years ago. But now it needs to sufficiently follow up on a really impressive car, a car that has become more impressive since it was canceled. I'm not sure they've done that. However, it is really important to note the good stuff is all here. BMW has great tech, and so this car has a lot of great tech, great safety features, good stuff. Visibility is great, drivability is great, steering and handling is good, doesn't feel too numb. Power, you know, is fine, it's good enough. And I think, generally speaking, this is a great sports car. I really do. I just don't know that it's quite a Supra. I think a little bit more can come out of that. And so, that's the 2020 Toyota Supra. This car is fine. Just fine. It's not an amazing legend revival like many of us were hoping for and dreaming about. Truthfully, this is a fun car. It's fun to drive. It's fantastic. I think it looks good, and it's a great sports car. But that's all it is. This isn't going to be selling for $100,000 at collector car auctions in 20 years like the old Supra. What this car is, though, is a good starting point, a good building block on which more Supra versions can come, and I seriously hope that this is just the beginning of the Supra revival with more powerful, more exciting versions on the horizon. But given that we all demanded that from Toyota with the FRS BRZ 86 and it never came, I fear that this is all the Supra we may ever get, which, again, is fine. Just fine. And with that, it's time to give the new Supra a Doug score.
Start
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the new Supra has been a bit controversial, but people always hate new car designs when they first see them. It's one of my great frustrations with car commenters. I like it and it gets a 7 out of 10. Acceleration does 0 to 60 in 4.1 seconds and it gets a 7 out of 10. Handling is sharp, feedback is good, steering is nice, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Fun factor is strong. This is an enjoyable car to toss around, but it's lacking the transmission that would truly make it excellent, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Finally, cool factor. This is one of the most hotly anticipated new cars, and it easily gets a 7 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 34 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The Supra is loaded with a lot of excellent tech, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Comfort is fine, normal for the class, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Quality is high, the interior is excellent, and all the materials are great. It doesn't get the usual Toyota scores because of the BMW drivetrain. Reliability could be a question, but it does well enough with a 7 out of 10. Practicality is okay, it has a decent sized cargo area, but only 2 seats, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Finally, value, and it's a good one. The Supra starts at like 50 grand, which is a huge discount compared to the Z4 with the same engine, which starts at 65 grand. Yes, the Z4 has more power, but 15 grand is 15 grand. The Supra gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 29 out of 50. Add it up and the Doug score is 63 out of 100. And here's how the Supra stacks up against the competition. It beats out the Lexus RCF, which was sort of a must in my mind for the Supra to be taken seriously. The Supra's only 1 point short of the BMW M2, which is pretty good. I like the M2, and I think that's high praise for the Toyota. The Supra also beats the Mustang GT. The Mustang is faster, but the Supra looks a little better, and the Supra has the wow factor right now as it's so hotly anticipated in the car world. Truthfully, the Supra places right where you'd probably expect it to. It's a good car, and it's seriously worth a look if you're interested in a good sports car. As long as you don't mind a sports car with a mandatory torque converter automatic transmission. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the Supra. And by the way, if you hear gunfire behind me, it's because I am filming this video in West Virginia, and well, take that how you want to. But anyway, on to more quirks and features, and I want to come back under the hood. Now, BMW seemed... Oh, oops. But anyway, on to more quirks and features, and I want to get back under the hood. Now, Toyota seemed to be very proud of the fact that they have two...